Hello everyone. Before we get into the science, I'm going to mention my affiliations. I'm a second year PhD student at UCAT and at the Forest Research Institute in the Karelian Republic in Russia. So now we can get into the science, and I hope you're ready because there will be some action, as my advisor would say. So I'm going to present some of the results I got for one of the chapters of my PhD project. I looked at the signal of the climate in the fire history of mixed pine forest in eastern North America. And for the climate, I specifically was interested in large-scale patterns of climate variability capturing climate indices that operate in the Pacific Ocean and the Atlantic Ocean. In the Pacific Ocean, I looked at ENSO, El Niño Southern Oscillation in the tropical Pacific. I also looked at PDO, Pacific Decadal Oscillation in the North Pacific. But for this set of analysis, I didn't get a significant pattern, so I won't talk about PDO. In the Atlantic Ocean, I looked at NOW, North Atlantic Oscillation Index, and at the AMO, Atlantic Multi-Decadal Oscillation. Okay, so let me state my hypothesis. Hypothesis one, there are climate indices states that are consistently associated with increased fire activity over the distribution range of mixed pine forests in eastern North America. And my hypothesis two is that these states mark periods of increased climatological fire hazard over the study area. To make it a little bit more clear, for example, El Niño, it goes through goes through two phases, El Niño and La Niña. During El Niño, there are warm anomalies in the tropical Pacific, and during La Niña, there are cold anomalies. So I wanted to see which one of these is fire prone. Let's go through the methods. So for the fire data, I synthesize dendrochronologically resolved fire history reconstructions completed in red pine forests. And then I built a network of sites in this area. So my network of sites roughly corresponds to the distribution range of red pine. Red pine is a very good recorder of fire in this area because it has a thick bark that it allows it to survive low to moderate severity fires. So it records the fire event. I should also mention that my fire history of the region covered 1675 to 1900s. And I made sure that each site was an independent observation by making sure that they are all at least 40 kilometers from one another. And for the climate data, I used the reconstructions of the climate indices that I mentioned. So for the analysis that I used, first I conducted superposed epoch analysis with each climate index, and in this superposed epoch analysis, the event years were high fire activity years. So I have to tell you something about the fire data set. So you understand how I define high fire activity years. So these reconstructions, these data sets that I used come from published papers. I also use some unpublished data sets from Igor Drobyshev. But in this part, it's usually only frequency data that is recovered as opposed to spatial data. So my high fire activity years are the years when we have the highest number of sites burned in synchrony, specifically the 10%. I also conducted cross correlation analysis when the climate and the fire data were aggregated in 5-year time steps. And I did this in part because since the fire records come from different authors, there could be some inconsistencies in the exact fire year. And to test my second hypothesis, I conducted field correlation analysis in Climate Explorer between these climate indices and surface weather conditions in the modern record. I'm going to show you surface temperature. So let's move to my results. So when I conducted superposed epoch analysis, only ENSO yielded a significant pattern. And during high fire activity years, ENSO had a positive anomaly from its mean, which is indicative of ENSO. And when I conducted a field correlation analysis in the modern record, ENSO also causes a higher, is associated with higher temperature in the area in the months preceding the fire season, in the winter and the spring. You are looking at this picture, you're looking at an average from January to April. And for the cross-correlation analysis, when the data is aggregated, now ENAMO yielded significant patterns. For now, it was a positive association. So positive now anomalies are the is the fire-prone state of now. And when I conducted a field correlation analysis in the modern day record, positive now is also associated with higher temperatures in the winter and the spring months preceding the fire season. I might have to skip AMO because of time restrictions. But don't worry, because ENSO and now they have very interesting stories. Okay, so we saw that ENSO and now their effect is the most prominent in the winter and the spring, and processes that occur in the winter and the spring that are important to the fire to the fire season is the formation of snowpack and the melting of snowpack. We saw that ENSO and now they both create mild winters and warm springs. And under these conditions, there would be less snowpack and also faster melting of the snowpack. And this could increase fire activity because it increases the time for fuels to dry and also the fire season. I'm going to explain to you, I'm going to explain to you why I think we found an association between El Niño and positive now with higher fire activity. First of all, I chose these indices because they are known to affect the general atmospheric circulation patterns in the Northern Hemisphere. They affect the jet stream in the mid-latitude, the polar front jet. And because this jet stream controls the weather and the extreme weather in the mid-latitudes, including eastern North America, then it's expected that there's going to be a teleconnection between these indices and fire activity in the area. So we know that during El Niño events, the conditions in the tropical Pacific get propagated to the Northern Hemisphere through Rossby waves. So when a positive anomaly of ENSO gets transferred to the Northern Pacific, it affects the Aleutian Low, which is a low pressure system in the North Pacific. And when the Aleutian Low gets stronger or gets deeper, then it can trigger the PNA pattern, the Pacific North Atlantic pattern. And the Pacific North Atlantic pattern is a configuration of the jet stream over North America. And you can see in this picture I made what it would look like. In the PNA pattern, there is a ridge in Western Canada. And there is a trough in Southeast United States. So we expect that when El Niño events occur, the jet stream is going to meander really south in the eastern North America, and this would allow intrusion from cold air intrusion from the Arctic to penetrate into our area and cause cold winters, which is not fire prone. However, the response of El Niño is nonlinear. And we know that when there are strong El Niño events, the Aleutian Low gets deepened, but it also moves to the east. And when this occurs, the typical PNA pattern doesn't get triggered. The ridge in Western Canada forms, but the trough in Eastern North America doesn't develop as much. So there is less intrusion of Arctic cold air into our area that results in milder winters and hotter springs and higher fire activity. Okay, so now, so we saw that the positive NAWA anomaly is the fire-prone state. And maybe in this picture that you can see, hopefully,